Assalamu alaikum, I'm Dr. Najam and I'll be presenting today's case of urological infections in immunocompromised patients. What are the learning objectives of today's topic? Who are the immunocompromised patients? The different categories of immunocompromised patients, why they are more susceptible to infections, the different urological infections in the immunocompromised patients and their treatment, and finally the take-home message. So, an immunocompromised patient is one whose immunity is attenuated for any reason, and therefore they are incapable of developing an adequate immune response, and impairment can be congenital or acquired. These are the broad categories of patients who have a compromised immune system. Patients with diabetes mellitus, they are the ones that we frequently come across. Patients with HIV/AIDS, transplant recipients receiving immunosuppressive drugs, inherited disorders like A gamma globulinemia or IgA deficiency, so hematological malignancies like leukemia, lymphoma, patients on chemo radiotherapy, and for certain cancers, autoimmune disorders like SLE and rheumatoid arthritis. These patients are receiving immunomodulating drugs that make them susceptible, and nutritional deficiencies like zinc and copper can induce a decreased immune system.
Can I add 2 points to this right now or in time? What I read somewhere is that sedentary lifestyle and obesity also depresses immune response. A person who walks and exercises and takes aerobic exercises, immunity is boosted. Decreasingly, and to my understanding, a person who is sick, very sick, is immunocompromised.
Exactly, ma'am. So, what causes the weakening of the immune defenses? Patients for receiving cancer treatment, like radiation, certain medicines, their skin lining or oral mucosa or GI lining breaks down, which causes penetration of the immune dispensers, and they develop infections. Decreased WBC count, as seen in certain cancers, are a side effect of medicines used for cancer treatment. So they have decreased immune defenses, or presence of foreign objects like IV cannulae and urinary catheters. They or indwelling catheters. They basically are helpful in the propagation of infection in these patients. We have to bear in mind that these patients are the patients who are immunocompromised. They might not display the classical signs of infection like redness or swelling. So we have to be careful, and we have to be wary of the fact that they might develop infection more quickly. Sometimes the only symptom could be a fever. In the absence of WBC, the infection may rapidly progress from a fever alone to sepsis and then death. And these patients, because of the weakened immune system, might have trouble clearing infection, simple infections like flu. According to the level of the tract that is involved, the infections could present as in the kidney in terms of pyelonephritis or pyonephrosis. They could be renal abscesses, as in Staph aureus septicemia. And as we come down into the lower tract, we could have involvement of the bladder, that is cystitis. Prostate could be involved as causing prostatitis, and finally urethritis. So, what is the general pathogenesis behind the UTI that also occurs in the immunocompromised patients? The microorganisms can reach the urinary tract by hematogenous or lymphatic route, but the main source is the ascent from the urethra, is the most common pathway that leads to UTI, especially the organisms that are prevalent in the gut, that is E. coli and Enterobacteriaceae species. So, What happens is that there is periurethral contamination by uropathogen that is residing in the gut that leads to the colonization of the urethra and then migration by the flagella and pili of the pathogen to the bladder or kidney. And bacterial adherence to the uroepithelium is key to the pathogenesis of UTI. Infections occur when bacterial virulence mechanisms overcome efficient host defense mechanisms, as these patients are already immune compromised, so that basically augments this mechanism. Upper UTI is like pyelonephritis developed when uropathogen ascend to the kidneys by the ureter. Infections can occur when bacteria bind to a urinary catheter, a kidney or bladder stone, or being retained in the urinary tract by a physical obstruction. Severe cases of pyelonephritis, in these cases, the affected kidney may be enlarged with raised abscesses on the surface. Staph aureus bacteremia or endocarditis can lead to hematogenous seeding of the bacteria to the kidneys, causing suppurative necrosis or abscess formation within the renal parenchyma. However, gram-negative bacilli rarely cause kidney infection by the hematogenous route. According to one experimental model of pyelonephritis, the main renal abnormality reported was inability to maximally concentrate the urine. And this concentration defect occurred early in the infection and is found to be rapidly reversible with antibiotic therapy. Any obstruction in the tract can lead to progressive destruction of the affected kidney and subsequent renal insufficiency. This table basically categorizes the different types of UTIs and what is more prevalent in patients with immune suppression is the complicated UTI. It's basically found in pregnant women, men with obstruction, patients on immunosuppression, patients having renal failure, renal transplantation patients. This figure depicts the as the severity of the infection progresses, like from asymptomatic bacteriuria, there might be no symptoms, and then it progresses to cystitis, which may present with dysuria, frequency, urgency, and then mild to moderate pyelonephritis and severe pyelonephritis that may present with fever, flank pain, nausea, vomiting, and finally this stage progresses to urosepsis, septic shock, and organ dysfunction and failure. So what is present in immunocompromised patients, they might initially be having minor symptoms. They might present with minor symptoms, but they may progress rapidly to urosepsis shock. So it is important to start prompt treatment in these patients and be wary of the fact that they might develop into a more severe form of infection. So we come to the first broad category of the patient those have depressed immune function, that is the diabetes patients, which we encounter mostly. So UTIs are more common and tend to have a more complicated course in patients with diabetes mellitus. Increased susceptibility with the longer disease duration and worsening diabetic severity. There's around a 2 to 5-fold increase in the incidence of acute pyelonephritis in diabetes patients compared with the non-diabetic patients. And complications like emphysematous pyelonephritis, renal and perirenal abscesses are frequently seen in these patients. The mortality and risk of hospitalization for UTI are not increased in patients with diabetes mellitus as such, but the length of hospitalization has been reported to be prolonged. Asymptomatic bacteria occurs in diabetic women more commonly than in the non-diabetics, and it is associated with increased risk of UTI among patients with type 2 diabetes. The treatment with antimicrobial therapy has not been shown to reduce symptomatic UTIs, pyelonephritis, or hospitalization for UTI. The risk of for UTI, it correlates with the degree of glycemia as measured by HbA1c. There is autonomic neuropathy in these patients, which leads to dysfunctional voiding and urinary retention that basically prevents the bacterial clearance and promotes the bacterial growth. Defects in local urinary cytokine secretions and an increased adherence of the microorganism to the uroepithelium contributes to the increased prevalence of both asymptomatic and symptomatic bacteriuria in these patients. The elevated glucose levels in the urine cause neutrophil dysfunction, which impedes phagocytosis, and therefore there's decreased clearance of bacteria, and bacterial invasion occurs and it progresses to UTI. However, no relationship between specific uropathogen prevalence and diabetes status has been found. However, diabetes patients with asymptomatic bacteriuria are likely to be infected by Klebsiella and Enterococcus than by E. coli. Despite more frequent resistant bacteria, empiric antibiotic therapy for a diabetic patient with complicated UTI is similar to that of non-diabetic patient. However, one important exception is that a Staph aureus infection is not uncommon in diabetic patients and can lead to urinary tract sepsis. And this should be considered especially when a diabetic patient presents with a renal carbuncle. The oral outpatient therapy is not recommended for the diabetic patient with a complicated UTI, and treatment with trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole should be avoided if possible, because it can potentiate the hypoglycemic effects of the oral hypoglycemic drugs. And in these patients, fluoroquinolones are safe and effective in the treatment of diabetic patients with complicated UTI. This flow chart basically shows the way forward for patients who present with the more severe form of pyelonephritis, that is the emphysematous pyelonephritis. So any diabetic patient that comes to you with fever and UTI, we should start prompt treatment like fluids and antibiotics and send urine and blood cultures. We should do the urine, the ultrasound KUB. If that comes out normal, we proceed with the antibiotics. If there is some obstruction like hydronephrosis, we should relieve that obstruction. We can go for stenting or drainage and continue with the antibiotics. However, if there's gas in the kidney urinary bladder or on the ultrasound, or we should proceed with the CT scan. If the CT scan shows gas in the collecting system alone, we go for drainage and continue the antibiotics. If there is no response, we proceed with the nephrectomy. However, if the CT scan shows gas in the renal parenchyma alone, that is the dry type, we should proceed with the nephrectomy. And if the gas and fluid in the perinephric tissue occurs in conjunction with the renal function, that is compromised, so we should go for antibiotics and drainage. And if still there is no response, we proceed with the nephrectomy. Another problem that arises in patients with diabetic or patients who might have HIV AIDS infection is the Fournier's gangrene. It is a form of necrotizing fasciitis of the perineum and the scrotal area. So it rapidly progresses to involve the whole of the perineum if not if prompt treatment is not started. So we should go for early surgical debridement and start broad spectrum antibiotic therapy. And there should be a glycemia control in these patients. We now come to the second category of the patients that we encounter in our setup, and that is the patients on the UTIs in patients with transplant. Especially the kidney transplant patients. So,
one thing I want to ask is, diabetes mellitus on the top of the list of immunocompromised patients who have urological infection and second transplant, is it like that?
No, it's not like that. It's just I've just presented it because we come across more patients that are diabetic because a lot of.
It's got a very high incidence.
Yes.
It is on the top, not HIV or kidney transplant.
So, infectious complications in kidney transplant recipients are associated with higher morbidity and mortality, and UTIs are the most common infections with a reported rate of around 45 to 72%. Varying definitions of UTI are the main reasons for the wide range of UTI rates reported for transplant patients. Ongoing improvements in kidney transplantation technique and immunosuppressive regimens also influence the UTI rates, and frequent updates of surveillance studies are necessary in these patients. It is estimated that almost half of kidney transplant patients will develop a UTI within 3 years of transplantation, and age has been identified as an independent risk factor for late-term post-transplantation UTI. All published reports on adults demonstrated that females had a higher risk of both acute and recurrent UTI. In the pediatric population, the risk is higher among males. Other risk factors identified are a longer pre-transplantation dialysis time and urinary tract obstruction. Urinary catheters are the most important manageable risk factors identified, and it has been shown that removal of urethral catheters within the first 24 to 48 hours after transplantation is safe. Unless any other individual patient characteristic that requires a prolonged bladder drainage exists, urethral catheters should be removed to avoid UTIs. It has also shown that routine prophylactic use of urethral stents are well tolerated and effective in reducing major urologic complications. However, the use without prophylactic antibiotics was associated with a higher risk of infection. Given the benefits of using urethral stents alongside prophylactic antibiotic, the optimal duration should be determined. Urinary tract obstruction is another urologic risk factor that can be managed to avoid infections. Post-transplantation antibiotic prophylaxis is used to reduce the risk of infectious complications, and the most common protocol is low-dose trimethoprim sulfamethoxol for 6 months. This time point is also used to differentiate between early and late UTI complications. In the order of frequency, the pathogens responsible for UTIs are as follows. It's E. coli, Enterococcus, and Pseudomonas, Staphylococcus, Klebsiella, Enterobacter, and Proteus species, and finally other bacteria and fungi. No detailed resistant profiles are available of bacteria and kidney transplant patients, and due to multiple healthcare exposure and long-term antibiotic prophylaxis, they are likely to have resistant pathogens. Symptoms of UTI in transplant patients may mimic other transplant-related pathologies or may not be present. Graft pain may be observed, but the absence of pain does not rule out an infection and should be accounted for when classifying the severity. A urine culture should be ordered in case of Lourdes fever or unexplained leukocytosis in these patients. There is no evidence to support routine screening of patients, and the treatment of UTIs should be tailored according to the individual patient characteristic alongside the severity classification. Management of asymptomatic bacteriuria is unclear, and overtreatment that leads to collateral damage is the main worry in these cases. The current EAU guideline does not recommend the treatment of ASB in renal transplant patients with an otherwise uncomplicated medical history, as there are no short or long-term benefits of antibiotic treatment. Empirical antibiotic treatment for symptomatic UTI is similar to that for the general population. However, the optimal treatment duration is not known, and in general, the practice is to provide antibiotics for a longer period of time. This is the summary of precautions to prevent UTIs in kidney transplant patients, and it shows that treat any infection in recipient before transplantation. should culture donor tissue sample and perfusate, perioperative antibiotic prophylaxis, perioperative low dose trimethoprim sulfamethoxol for 6 months, empirical treatment of overt infection, and remove a urethral catheter within 24 to 48 hours. Another category is the HIV/AIDS patients who have a repressed immune system and who come with a UTI. So HIV alters the normal host defense against bacterial infection. When the CD4 lymphocyte count falls to less than 200 cells per ml, the risk of bacterial and opportunistic fungal UTI increases dramatically. And in addition, the antiretroviral medications used to treat HIV, example, the zidovudine, can further suppress normal immune response and increase the risk of UTI in these patients. The other atypical infections include Candida, Aspergillus, and Cryptococcus. Popelman et al. 1992 obtained urine cultures from HIV positive men prospectively and when they had symptoms suggestive of a UTI. And they observed that the positive urine cultures were identified in 30% of HIV infected men when the CD4 count was less than 200, while none of the cultures were positive when CD count was more than 500. Gugino et al. 1998 similarly observed that the incidence of bacteriuria in asymptomatic HIV infected women was the same as that in uninfected women because of the common prophylactic use of trimethoprim sulfamethoxol to prevent pneumocystis carinii, pneumonia in AIDS patients. The incidence of UTI in this group was found to be decreased. Prostatitis in HIV patients, the incidence of bacterial prostatitis is approximately 3%, and it is 14% in patients with AIDS, compared with around 1-2% in non-infected men of similar age, as reported by Leport. Causative organisms include common prostatitis pathogens like E. coli and Proteus species, and other less common organisms such as Salmonella typhi, Staph aureus, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and Neisseria gonorrhoeae. Prolonged treatment 4 to 6 weeks with fluoroquinolones may be necessary because of a high risk of reinfection and lower immunity status in these patients. Prostatic abscess is more common in patients with AIDS compared with that in the general population, as reported by Stamen and Louis. Positive organisms include E. coli and other gram-negative bacteria or opportunistic fungus or mycobacterial infection. Effective drainage and prolonged antimicrobial or antifungal therapy are needed. Epididymitis in these patients caused by mostly Neisseria gonorrhoeae and Chlamydia trachomatis. However, infection by coliform bacteria such as E. coli is more common, especially in patients having unprotected anal intercourse. In HIV-infected patients with suppurative or antibiotic-resistant epididymitis, infection with fungi or mycobacteria should be considered. In HIV-infected men with urethritis, treatment for both Chlamydia and Neisseria gonorrhoeae is indicated even when gonococcus is isolated only from culture, secondary to the high co-infection rate. And because of the increased viral shedding with genital infection, it is recommended that the HIV-infected patients abstain from sexual intercourse for until 7 days after treatment is completed. Infection by other uncommon organisms in HIV patients show that urinary infection with Mycobacterium species can develop in HIV-infected patients. Kidneys are first infected, and then infection spreads into the lower tract. In patients with AIDS, it is estimated that 6-23% have renal tuberculosis based on renal tissue biopsy during necropsy. Mycobacterium tuberculosis is the most common pathogen, and Mycobacterium avium and Mycobacterium intercellulare are less common. In HIV-infected patients who present with irritative obstructive voiding symptom but have no evidence of bacterial infection on culture, infection of the lower urinary tract by Mycobacterium species should be considered. Few patients present with hematuria or sterile pyuria. Treatment with at least two anti-tuberculosis agents is needed for 6 to 9 months, which can improve proteinuria and renal function, as noted by Norse and colleagues when children with HIV and disseminated tuberculosis were evaluated. So, the message to take home regarding this presentation was that there should be a high index of suspicion for UTI in any patient, any immunosuppressed patient. There should be low threshold for starting treatment in these patients, that these patients might just have a fever and it could quickly progress to urosepsis and shock. Prompt treatment should be initiated so as to prevent the patient progressing into sepsis or septic shock.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The comment from myself is wherever the immunocompetent cells are decreased by any means, maybe it is because of diabetes or it is because of overwhelming infection, having CD4 count less than what you have mentioned, then the signs of inflammation will not be expected to occur. And why they should not occur, just because of the reason that for instance leukocytes, their movement is slowed down because of many factors. Either they are not there, or they are slowed down because of, for instance, diabetes mellitus. Because of glycosylation of the cytoskeleton, the movement is not proper. And when it is when the immunocompetent cells are not there, the infection will be will not have any hindrance to spread. So you have rightly pointed out in your message, take home message, that whenever there is a threshold of these conditions that you have mentioned, then one should not wait for the signs to appear. One should always be apprehensive and start the treatment early, so that we'll be able to contain the disease or other. Eradicate the disease. Otherwise, if you, for instance, whenever we work in a post-transplant clinic, this is a practice and this is the teaching that anybody who works there and sees a patient, there should be a lot of things at the back of the mind. For instance, there might be opportunistic infection. So the patient won't tell you that I have got fever. The patient won't tell you anything related to inflammation. You have to put yourself into that kind of a scenario, and you should always eradicate the doubts that come to your mind rather than the other way around. So I think the take home message is very clear. The low threshold for starting the treatment should be in all these conditions that you have mentioned.
Since the already most frequent group that we deal with immunocompromised group is transplant patient, and when there is infection in the transplant patient, then you have to consider the immunosuppressive therapy as well. So on one side, if you decrease immunosuppressive therapy, there is risk of rejection, and if you increase it, there is risk of infection. And when these patients present, the presentation of rejection and infection is similar. So you have to differentiate between the two, and then you have to decide whether you want to decrease your immunosuppression or whether you want to change it so that you can control the infection.